In this video, we will show you three different types of perturbation theory. First, we look at time-independent perturbation theory. There are two cases, whether we have degeneracy or not. Later on, we cover time-dependent perturbation theory. Now, this video won't show you all the detailed calculations on how to arrive at these equations, but rather explain how to use them in order to solve actual problems, so keep that in mind. We will always consider the same system. We have a Hamiltonian, H0, and its solutions, psi n, with corresponding eigenvalue energies, En. This Hamiltonian could, for instance, describe a hydrogen atom, a harmonic oscillator, or simply a particle in a box. To this unperturbed Hamiltonian, we add a potential. This potential usually comes with a parameter, lambda, which is taken to be much smaller than 1. This means that the new potential only slightly alters our previous Hamiltonian and that we can start to apply perturbation theory. First off, standard time-independent non-degenerate perturbation theory, also known as Rayleigh-Schrödinger perturbation theory. Since lambda is very small, we assume that we can write the energy eigenvalue of the whole system as a power series. The first term is the energy of the unperturbed Hamiltonian. This would be exact if lambda were 0. But for a non-zero lambda, we expect there to be some corrections. The subscript n tells us which eigenfunction we are considering, and the number in brackets indicates the degree of correction. So for instance, e to 1 is the first correction term to the second energy eigenvalue. But not only the energies, also the eigenfunctions will be changed due to the new potential term. So we make a similar ansatz for the eigenfunctions as a power series in lambda. It is conventional to claim that these corrections are orthogonal to the original eigenfunction. Now, all we need is to know how to calculate these corrections. Usually, we calculate the energy up to second order and the eigenfunctions up to first order. The first order correction to the nth energy eigenvalue is given by a matrix element where we evaluate the new potential between the unperturbed nth eigenfunctions. That's usually a rather quick calculation. For the second order correction, we have to do a bit more. First off, we have to calculate a matrix element of the new potential between the nth unperturbed eigenfunction and the kth unperturbed eigenfunction, and take the absolute square. Then we divide it by the difference between the unperturbed nth and kth energy. And we do this for all eigenfunctions, except for the nth one, because then we would have to divide by 0. This sounds like a huge task, but most of the time this is simpler than it looks. In a finite dimensional Hilbert space, you often only have 2 or 3 eigenfunctions, so you don't have to calculate many terms. And for an infinite dimensional Hilbert space, you can make use of the orthogonality of the eigenfunctions, which yields Kronecker deltas, which in turn eliminate the sum from this equation. For the first correction to the nth eigenfunction, we do a similar calculation like for the second order energy correction, however, without the absolute square, and afterwards we multiply this number with the kth eigenfunction. That's usually it for Rayleigh-Schrödinger perturbation theory. Now let's look at what happens when we have degeneracy in our system. This means that 2 eigenstates, psi1 and psi2, have the same energy. Let's call it epsilon. But still, psi1 and psi2 are distinct eigenfunctions, which means they are orthogonal. What comes now should only be applied to psi1 and psi2, since all other eigenfunctions can be handled by Rayleigh-Schrödinger perturbation theory. For psi1 and psi2, we only consider the subspace of the new potential V spanned by these 2 functions. For example, if the diagonalized Hamiltonian can be written as 0, epsilon, epsilon, 3 epsilon, we see that the eigenvalues are 0, epsilon, and 3 epsilon. So for psi 0 and psi 3, we apply non-degenerate perturbation theory. But here, we have a degeneracy. This means, however the potential may look like, we only consider this 2x2 matrix. We will use this potential to lift the degeneracy, and to do that, we solve its eigenvalue problem. This provides us with 2 eigenvalues and 2 corresponding eigenvectors. The eigenvectors can be used to construct the corrections to the eigenfunctions. If the first eigenvector is ab, then the new eigenfunction, let's call it psi1, is given by a times psi1 plus b times psi2. And its energy? The corresponding eigenvalue of the 2x2 potential is the first order correction to epsilon. The other eigenvector can be used in the same way to construct psi2, which is given by c times psi1 plus d times psi2. and the corresponding eigenvalue is the first order correction to epsilon. Here we clearly see that due to the potential V, our energies are not degenerate anymore. The second order correction to the energy works similar to the non-degenerate case. However, now we exclude both the state 1 and 2 in the summation. There we go. We have a new set of eigenfunctions, psi 1 and psi 2, as well as energy corrections up to second order. Finally, let's move to time-dependent perturbation theory. In this case, the new potential term V is a function of time, V of t. The usual goal of time-dependent potential is to move from one eigenfunction to another. So this is what we'll cover here. In particular, the problem will sound something like this. Our system is in an initial eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, psi I, with energy Ei. At time t equals 0, we turn on a potential, V of t. What is the probability that after a certain time interval, delta t, the system is found to be in another eigenfunction of the Hamiltonian, a certain final state, psi f? To answer this, we first calculate the so-called transition amplitude, AIF, that takes us from the initial to the final state. It's given by 1 over I h bar, then the integral from 0 to delta t, d tau. We integrate over the matrix element of the potential, V of tau, between the initial and the final state. Finally, we add an exponential function, e to the I omega IF tau, where omega IF is defined to be the energy difference of the final state minus the initial state divided by h bar. Delta t can be finite, it can be infinity, whatever the problem tells us. After calculating the transition amplitude, we get the transition probability by taking the absolute square of the amplitude. So this is now the probability that a potential V of t switches our initial state psi I to a certain final state psi f within a time interval delta t. That's pretty much it for perturbation theory. Thanks for watching.